Welcome to Worship with the People and Friends of Living Water Lutheran Church in Centerville, Ohio. It's July 12, 2020, the sixth Sunday after Pentecost, and I'm glad that you're able to be with us here for worship today. Here are a few announcements. If you're watching this early on Sunday morning, you may still have time to make the congregational meeting that's taking place at 10 a.m. at the Mandalay Banquet and Event Center in Moraine. The purpose of the meeting is threefold. One, to approve going ahead with the construction of our building expansion. Two, to approve financing for that. And finally, to approve a constitutional amendment that will allow future congregational meetings to happen, at least in part, online. We're going to be maintaining good social distance through this meeting. We ask everyone to wear masks and gloves. We'll need to only sit with persons that we've come to there in our cars or people from our households. And I've been advised also by the folks at Mandalay that they will have sanitizing stations in the facility and that only three people will be able to occupy either restroom at any given time. Again, I want to say a word to those who, like me, are over the age of 65. If you decide you can't attend, as several people have indicated to me they can't, that is entirely understandable. I want to remind you that on weeknights, including tomorrow night, Monday, we have an online Bible study on Facebook Live. It happens at 9 p.m. Tomorrow we'll be looking at Matthew chapter 25. I hope you can be with us. Today our message will be presented by Bishop Dan Selbo of the North American Lutheran Church. He's allowing me the time I need on Saturday, which I would ordinarily be using to prepare for the worship service, so that I can take care of my mother-in-law's graveside service on Saturday. Bishop Selbo loves Jesus, and he has a fantastic servant's heart. He's also a great leader. Thank you, Bishop Selbo, for being with us today. One last reminder, tonight, Sunday night, 6 o'clock p.m., you can go to YouTube Live and we will celebrate together Holy Communion. Just prepare bread and wine or grape juice in your home and we'll celebrate the sacrament. And now let's begin our worship service with the confession and absolution. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority. I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sin in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. I ask you now to join me in the Kyrie. Respond with each petition with the words, Lord, have mercy. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For Christ's holy Church, and for all members of his body who offer him worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. We now read responsively Psalm 65, verses 9 to 13. I will read the odd verses, and I ask you to read the even verses. You care for the land and water it. You enrich it abundantly. The streams of God are filled with water to provide the people with grain, for so you have ordained it. You drench its furrows and level its ridges. You soften it with showers and bless its crops. You crown the year with your bounty, and your carts overflow with abundance. The grasslands of the wilderness overflow. The hills are clothed with gladness. The meadows are covered with flocks, and the valleys are mantled with grain. They shout for joy and sing. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, scatter the seed of your word in our hearts. Grant that it may be received in joy, sprout, and bear the fruits of your mercy as we grow in faith, hope, and love. Then send us into your world to scatter the seeds of your love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our first lesson comes to us from the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verses 10 through 13. As the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return to it without watering the earth and making it bud and flourish, so that it yields seeds for the sower and bread for the eater, so is my word that goes out from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but will accomplish what I desire and achieve the purpose for which I sent it. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush will grow the juniper, and instead of the briars, the myrtle will grow. This will be for the Lord's renown, for an everlasting sign that will endure forever. Our second lesson comes to us from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. If indeed we share in his sufferings, in order that we may also share in his glory. Our gospel lesson comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 1 through 9 and 18 through 23. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it, while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, "A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places, where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly, because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched and they withered, because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Whoever has ears, let them hear." Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in their heart. This is the seed sown along the path. The seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word, but the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, making it unfruitful. But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown.
Well, dear friends, greetings today in the name of our Lord Jesus, and thank you for the opportunity to share in your worship. I appreciate the invitation as well as a chance to share with you from God's Word. I'm in my home office here in San Jose, California, and sharing this message with you. I imagine most of you are out near where the congregation at Living Water is in Ohio. Before getting into our message, allow me to share just a few words about what's happening throughout the NALC. It is, as I'm sure you can imagine, been a challenging time in our ministries as we've had to adjust all kinds of things since the beginning of this pandemic. It's challenging enough when things are normal and we know what to expect. It's even more challenging when all of a sudden the rules change and we have to become more creative. Nonetheless, even having said that, I've been very encouraged by what's happening and the way in which our pastors and congregations have adjusted to meet the needs. The ministries are still happening. And with some of the online technology, I've been hearing stories that I actually believe we're reaching more people today than we might have otherwise been doing. So, you know, it's amazing what God does in the midst of these things, these situations, and uses them for his glory. And he uses it in ways to transform lives and to change lives as the message of Jesus Christ is shared. No surprise. On the church-wide level, we're also adjusting the way in which we're coming at things with our staff, with our elected and appointed leaders. This past week, we had an online meeting with some of our seminary students, some of which are on the front end of their seminary training. Others are coming near the close. It's not ideal to have these meetings online when a big part of what we do in the church, obviously, is to build relationships with each other and to get to know each other and live together in Christ. At the same time, those relationships are being built and we are being drawn together. In the midst of all of this, as long as we remember who we are and who we are following and what we are called to do, it doesn't ultimately matter that we can't be together, even if, you know, we're together online. And if we've been surprised or challenged at things that we didn't see coming, because we follow the one and we serve the one who knew this was coming. And he was not surprised, and he never is. In spite of the uncertainties we've been facing since the beginning of this pandemic, and now even as many of our churches are reopening and moving forward in the work that we share, let's not forget what we are doing in the church and why it is so desperately needed in the world. If nothing else, in the midst of this pandemic and when things have been put on edge with the, even more so with the racial tensions found throughout our country, we need to continually be reminding ourselves that our calling to speak the name of Jesus has not changed. And our commission to follow Jesus and to make disciples of Jesus is as important today as it's ever been. It is a challenging time in the life of the church, but it's also an opportunistic time to follow Jesus. Thank you to Pastor Daniels for the invitation to be with you here today. I've enjoyed working with him as we've been serving together over the years as deans, also on the Life to Life discipleship team, and now in this new role I have as bishop. Don't tell him I said this, but he's a good man. He's a faithful pastor. He's become a good friend. And the congregation at Living Water is and has been blessed by his leadership. Thanks for the chance to share. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Lord God, by your goodness to us, by your grace, and through the saving work you've accomplished for us in Jesus, you've brought us together in the church. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit, who leads us in life, who guides us in life, who leads us back to Jesus. Open our hearts to sense your presence. Speak to us in your word. In Jesus' name, amen. A certain sower went out to sow some seed. And he was a good sower. He scattered the seed wherever he could. But all the seed didn't grow. Some of the seed fell on the road and was eaten by the birds. Some fell among rocks and was scorched by the sun. Some fell among thorns, and although it had a good beginning, was choked out before it had a chance to fully take root. And still some good seed fell on good soil and produced a great harvest. Whoever has ears to hear, let him hear. Let's start today with a question. And be honest with yourself in answering. There's no right and wrong answer. You tell me. Have you ever heard a story but didn't really hear the story? Have you ever been told something 1 minute but can't seem to remember the next what it was you were just told? Doesn't happen in my life too often, at least as far as I know it doesn't, but it happened a while back. I was in a staff meeting online. We're doing more of those, as I've shared these days, than I ever would have imagined. It's not ideal, but we're certainly making it work, and most likely we'll continue doing more of it even as things begin to settle. Nevertheless, there is a point at which, after a while, your mind starts to wander, even if you're a bishop. It's hard to stay focused. We were about an hour and a half into it and getting near the end. It was a conversation about our upcoming convocation in August, the annual gathering of our church, and how we're going to be holding it online as well. As important as the discussion was, my mind was distracted and I didn't even realize it. At least not until I asked a question that one of the other staff members had just answered. I got these respectful but blank stares from the other staff, who realized before I did that I had not fully heard what apparently had been clearly said. You ever had that kind of experience? Conversations in which you thought you were engaged, but your engagement was not as focused as you thought? Times when you heard what was being said, maybe even on Sunday morning in the church, but didn't actually hear and take to heart how important it really was. In our text today, Jesus was experiencing an unprecedented popularity with people. Many had come to listen that day, but not all had come to hear. In fact, sitting on the shores of Galilee were probably as wide a variety of ears as could have possibly been together in one place. There were big ears, little ears, ears that stuck out and ears that lay close to the head. There were expectant ears, curious ears, ears filled with presuppositions and prejudices from the past. There were ears that had heard it all before and ears that were hearing it for the first time. There were ears assembled that day with a sincere desire to listen to what Jesus had to say and learn from his teaching and to change their lives. And there were ears that had come there that day not to hear, but to trap Jesus in his own words. Jesus was a tremendous teacher, the greatest teacher that has ever been. He knew the ears that were there that day. He knew the reasons why they had come to hear, and then he knew who would hear and who would not. And so he used the opportunity to teach a lesson that is instructive even for us today. Let's talk for a few moments about the parable, about the story Jesus told. First, about the sower. The sower is wonderful. I love the way he works. His job is to scatter the seed. And so scatter the seed he does. And it's not just on good soil, but everywhere he can. You can picture it. The sower walks along and with his bag of seed, looking not only for prime places in which he can selectively plant his seeds, but throwing it out wherever he goes. He doesn't care where it lands, whether it grows, whether he's wasting his time. He simply scatters it, leaving the growth of the seed to someone else. That's the work of the sower. That's what the sower's job is all about. And the sower, Jesus says in the story, is God. The sower in the story is the church. The sower in the story is anyone willing to share his or her faith with someone willing to listen. That's what Jesus did throughout his ministry. He wasn't selective with whom he shared the word. Great crowds gathered, Matthew tells us, to hear what Jesus had to say. Jesus didn't ask up front whether or not they were willing to hear and to listen. He simply scattered the seed. He threw it out. If it landed on receptive ears, it would grow. If it landed on unreceptive ears, it would not. But he didn't check it out first before throwing out the seed. He just threw it out wherever he could. He simply planted it whenever he had the chance. So it is in the church, right? We don't ask people as they come to worship whether they're willing to hear. We don't selectively plant the seeds depending on what they say. We just throw them out. We just let them go out and land where they will. And if they grow, they grow and they take root and they produce. If they don't, they don't. But that doesn't change what we're called to do. Remember what the Apostle Paul said? Paul says, I planted and Apollos watered, but it's God who gives the growth. Have you ever thought about that in relation to your own life? Have you ever thought about that, what it means when it comes to the responsibility you and I have been given as members in Christ's church? I'll talk about my own calling in life for a moment. As a pastor and now as a bishop, I could get very discouraged very quickly if I started to take responsibility for whether the seeds I've scattered over the years ever produced. Of all the people that have come and gone during my ministry, if every seed that was sown had taken root, I couldn't tell you how many people there would now be. It would be a lot. But the reality is it hasn't happened. If I started taking responsibility for that, I'd become very discouraged very quickly. My guess is if you were to look at the same efforts, the same kind of things in your own life, so would you. The good news in the story is that it's not up to us. It's up to God. That's what Jesus wants us to hear. Don't get discouraged. That's what he's saying. Don't let seemingly unproductive planting efforts become personal and get you down. The good news, it's not up to us. It's up to God. But it also works both ways. It really does. Have you ever thought about that? Just as I could give you a long list of people with whom I've shared my faith, but from whom, as far as I can tell, there's been little, if any, growth. So I could give you a long list of people that I would have never expected to become faithful Christians, but who now are. You know what? That's exactly what the story is about. The sower sows the seed, and the seed begins to grow, but it's not always evident where the growth will come. That's why the sower keeps on sowing. That's why the church and its people continue to share and to plant. It's God who takes the seed, and it's God who works in people's lives to enable it to take root and to grow. But the truth still remains. Seeds need to be planted in order to produce. If you fail to sow the seed, don't be surprised when there's little, if no, results. I read an article not long ago written for us as preachers. The title was, "The Gospel Assumed is the Gospel Denied." It was talking about the sharing of our faith, the sharing of the message of Jesus, and how pastors make the mistake too often of thinking that everybody already knows what the good news is all about. We come to our preaching, it said, thinking that everyone knows that Jesus died on the cross for their sins. So we fail to say it. We climb into the pulpit thinking it's already public knowledge that there's eternal life waiting for you in Christ. So we fail to proclaim it. The result is that we've assumed the gospel and, in effect, denied our hearers the promise of God's word. That's a good reminder for us who are preachers. But there's application of that same lesson even if you're not. I mean, really, the same thing can happen to parents. If we think as parents that our kids are going to pick up on the story of Jesus themselves without us, we're wrong. One of the primary tasks of Christian parenting is to make sure our children hear the story of Jesus over and over again from us. We need to share it. Same thing can happen at work. If we think that someone else will share the faith with that coworker who doesn't know and isn't connected with the church family, we failed in our job as sowers. Someone else might share it, and that's great, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be sharing it as well. And what about that kid at school who doesn't have any friends? Do you think God cares about that other kid as much as he cares about you? Of course he does. But that friend needs to know that. And what about your neighbor? And what about that widow or widower down the street? And what about that friend or that relative or that person you keep on bumping into at the store. My friends, the lesson is simple. If we assume people already know, then we fail in our calling as sowers. If we take for granted that the story has already been told, then we've sold out on our responsibility to be witnesses and messengers for Christ. So let me do a little sowing, just to make sure that I don't assume here too much here today, without even knowing where and how it'll hit. Here it comes. Are you ready? Here are just a few seeds God wants to plant in your hearts. Your sins are forgiven because of Jesus. God loves you more than you know, and more than you can even imagine. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. There's a home waiting in heaven for those who put their faith in Jesus. God is with you wherever you go. God knows more about your life than you could even remember yourself. You don't have to be afraid, no matter what it is that you're facing today. You don't have to wonder or worry what's happening in your life, because God knows and He cares, and God promises to never let you go. That's the job of the sower. The sower's job is to sow the seed. And the sower doesn't have to worry about what happens when the seed is sown. The sower simply throws it out. And then later on down the road, the watering and the fertilizing and the pruning and harvesting take place. Just think about your own life. How many people over the years have played a part in the growth and development of your faith? I'll bet if you sat down and made a list, it would be quite a few. You'd come up with more names than you might have at first thought. For most of us, myself included, that's the way it's been. Our faith development is something that has taken years. I mean, you don't plant the seed one day and expect a great return the next. But if you keep on planting, the return will come. If you keep on sowing, eventually the seed will take root and grow. In the story Jesus told, He talked about four different kinds of soil. First, He talked about the seed that was sown along the path. Analogous, He said, to the one who hears the word of God and fails to understand. When that happens, Jesus says, that's when the devil comes along and snatches the seed before it begins to take root. Just think about it. It's certainly the case in our world. How many people in our world fail to understand? And as a result, never come to faith. The Bible says faith comes from hearing, and hearing comes from the word of God. But you need to keep on hearing if you're going to grow. You need to continually stay in touch with God's word if it's ever going to produce. Jesus went on to talk about the seed that was planted on rocky ground. This is the seed, Jesus says, that gets sown in shallow soil, in lives where there's a surface attraction, you might say, to Jesus, but where there's no depth for the seed to take root and grow. When that happens, Jesus says, when any troubles or conflicts come along, the seed stops growing because there's not enough soil to give it growth. Again, just think about it. How many people start out fast in their faith and then fade in their efforts over time? Paul talks about the Christian life as a race in which we need to keep on running. And when we keep on running, he says, that's when we'll realize we can make it, because we're not alone. From there, Jesus talks about the seed that falls among thorns. Now, personally, I think this is what happens most often, and not just out where I live out in California. I think it's happening all throughout the world, certainly throughout the NALC. Because what are the thorns? Jesus says the thorns are the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth. I hope you realize that. Satan, the deceiver, can get you in one of two ways. Either he can get you worrying about things in your life so much that you take your eyes off of the cross and what Jesus has accomplished for you, or it can get you to focus too often and too closely and too much upon the riches you already have. And so thinking start, and then you start thinking there's no need. It's happening all around us, Jesus says. It's happening everywhere you turn in life. Don't let it happen to you. That's the warning Jesus gives. Then finally, Jesus talks about the good soil, about the productive soil, about the soil that's ready to hear and to receive and to trust in the promise of God's word. When the seed gets planted there, Jesus says, the result will be tremendous, 30, 60, even 100-fold. Remember the words from the first lesson? My word will not return empty, says the Lord. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to it without watering the earth, so will my word accomplish the purpose for which it was sent. And so, my friends, where does that leave us here today? What are the lessons we need to remember and to learn? Let me summarize what we said. Number one, the sower's job is to sow the seed. He doesn't worry about where it hits. He simply throws it out and lets it land. So it is with us as we live out and share our faith. Don't be selective in living your life as a Christian. Let everything you do bear witness to the one who is your Lord. Number two, don't assume that everyone knows the story. In fact, it's probably more accurate to assume that they do not. Talk about your faith. Live out your faith, not in your face kind of way, but sharing it. Sharing what you when you have a chance, and then trusting that God is at work to use your witness in his time. Number three, the seed of our witness will fall on a variety of soils. It's important to note that everyone has a different life experience. Not everyone will respond in the same way. But just because the response isn't there doesn't mean that the sowing was for naught. All it means is that the soil was not ready, at least not yet. Number four, don't feel responsible when the seeds fail to produce. Don't get discouraged when the seed fails to grow. Just because we can't see it doesn't mean that it's not happening. Growth happens slowly over time and most often in ways we will never see. Number five, the seed has power to bring about change. Rocky ground can become fertile soil if given the right amount of fertilizer and care. Hard and beat down paths can become furrows of productive land if given a bit of help. So it is with people. So it is when the word of God touches people's lives. And finally, number six, the seed of God's word will produce. The end result will be greater than you and I might ever expect. Don't sell the word short. Trust it to do what God has promised. It will not return empty. And so in closing, let me ask you again. Have you ever heard a story but didn't really hear the story? Have you ever been told something one minute but can't seem to remember the next what it was you just heard? Jesus tells his followers, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. So it is with you. So it is with me. So it is with us. My friends, it's time to listen up. Let's pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for the power of your word, for the way in which your word breaks into our lives and takes root and begins to grow. We thank you for the faith that comes through the work of your Holy Spirit, and the way in which that faith grows in us and through us to touch other lives as well. Lord, help us to be faithful as sowers. Help us to not be afraid to speak and to share the name of Jesus. Lord, use our efforts, use our lives, use our words and our gifts to grow your kingdom. We thank you for the chance we have to worship today, for the chance we have each week to gather together as your God, as your people. I pray your blessing upon Living Water Lutheran Church, upon Pastor Daniels, and upon the ministry that is shared together in that place. Lord, continue to work through them, work through all of us, that your church, even the North American Lutheran Church, might grow and increase and produce to the glory of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Thanks once again for the chance to share.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, you call us together as one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, not just as an individual congregation, but as people from around the world who are one in Jesus Christ. We thank you for the opportunity you give us to serve together with one another in the North American Lutheran Church. We pray your blessings of wisdom and safety for Bishop Dan Selbo, the staff of the NALC, and for our Dean, Pastor Paul Schultz. Bless, too, the ministries with which we are involved in our community and world, especially the St. Vincent Gateway Center, the Christian Life Center, Love Monkey Ministries, Miami Valley Women's Center, SMI Haiti, India Transformed, Interfaith Hospitality Network, Group Work Camps, and NALC Disaster Response, among others. Strengthen our work as the body of Christ that the gospel will be rightly proclaimed and disciples will be made and strengthened in their faith, and that your love may be experienced by the whole world. Let us pray to the Lord. Healing God, as we continue to experience what the public health experts tell us may simply be the first wave of the coronavirus pandemic, we pray that you will bring healing and thwart any lasting damage to those who suffer or have suffered from the disease, that you will comfort the hundreds of thousands of Americans and others around the world mourning the loss of loved ones and friends to this deadly enemy. We pray, Lord, that you give both your wisdom and the courage to act on it to all public officials, that you will guide those seeking vaccines, and that you will help us to secure each other's lives and freedom by heeding the advice of medical people. Most of all, Lord, we ask that by whatever means you choose, you will bring an end to this pandemic. Let us pray to the Lord. Most gracious God, you have promised to be with us always. To those whom you have given many years, grant that they may continue to join in thanking you for all the bounty of your overflowing love. Continue to uphold them, Lord, with strength and dignity. Abide with them that they may continue to bear witness to your unending presence. We give thanks for the elders in our congregation who have taught us and supported us in the faith. Let us pray to the Lord. Almighty Father, your Son Jesus shows us that you care about our every moment. This day we give you thanks in bringing healing from cancer to Betsy Davis Keys. In Jesus' name we pray for healing for Linda Spangler, Sue Hendrickson, Gladys Fuller, Bill Morgan, Claire Shaning, Roger Rhodes, Jean Poor, John Collins, Ruth Olson, Jane Griffith, Marianne Hall, Eric Walker, Bob Scoville, Bob Adkins, Bill Wood, Danny Turner, Lexi, Melinda, Jim Connerty, Laura Clark, Brody Braden, Steve Scoville, Shannon Harrison, Jamise Reeves, Gillian, Aaron, Mary Johnson, Charlotte Scoville, Jenny Linhoff, Nancy Hess, Bill Heath, and Terry Heath. Let us pray to the Lord. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let's join together now to confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We join together now to pray the prayer our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Go in peace, share the good news. Thanks be to God.